Thank you so much. It's an honor to be with all of you, and certainly reading those letters of acceptance on the wall. Really, letters are a very important part of my life that you'll learn. And I was asked to start my talk at the podium so they could take a picture. Are we done? All right. I like to get close, up close and personal. You know, when I'm lecturing and I notice one of my students, for some unknown reason, falls asleep, I tend to go up and sit next to them and then wake them up, and they never do that ever again. And mostly all the messages sent to every student in the class, this is not a good place to fall asleep because he's literally going to do it. And I did it once in a classroom where there was 4,000 kids. It was way up in the back, and I went up there and we had a little chat. But anyway, my love affair with the ocean began very, very early in my life. Although I was born in Wichita, Kansas, where all oceanographers come from, I was born 6 months after Pearl Harbor in June of 1942. And my father took the family and off we went from Wichita. And I woke up, I don't remember Wichita at all, but the tornado blew our house in a different direction than Oz. And that was to a place called Muroc in the Mojave Desert. My father was a test pilot with Chuck Yeager during the war. And as you know, Muroc later became Edwards Air Force Base. But shortly after the war ended, we moved again. And this kid from Kansas was planted in the warm sands of San Diego, next to the largest oceanographic institution in the world, the Scripps Institute of Oceanography, and not far from the submarine base down at Ballast Point near Point Loma in downtown San Diego. So in many ways, I'm just a product of this amazing country. I'm a 13th generation Ballard who came to Williamsburg in 1635 on a ship, the James. And our family just kept walking. Stopped off to have me in Kansas, and then continued the journey to the Pacific Ocean, and I just kept walking. When I was growing up, Scripps was a monumental institution within San Diego at this time. It's very, very early. This is in the late 40s. And then I entered high school, and I wrote a letter to Scripps. Very much a Dear Santa Claus letter. And I'm dyslexic, so I'm sure I misspelled oceanography. But anyway, I gave it my best. And like so many letters, they, you know, you think, well, they're just going to vanish. And fortunately, a kind researcher named Norris Rakestraw, who was actually at the time studying CO2 concentrations in the atmosphere. Isn't that amazing? And it responded to my letter. And I got this response, said, well, actually, we have a program for children like you. I was in junior in high school, and the National Science Foundation had a program for rising seniors, and I filled out the application and was lucky enough to receive that scholarship in the summer of 1959. I went to see, you can do your math, I'm 72, but anyway, I went to Scripps and was further lucky to be selected out of the group of 30 students. Two of us were allowed to go to sea. And I went to sea on my first oceanographic expedition in the summer of 1959, out way out to sea, 500 miles out in this neck of the woods. And we got hammered. We got in an amazingly horrible storm, as only the North Pacific can deliver, because storms, the strength of the storm and the strength of the size of waves is driven by three characteristics, two of which seem very logical. One is the speed at which the wind is blowing is one factor in the size of a swell. The second is how long it's been blowing. But the third is the one that you don't normally think of. It's called the fetch. And that's the distance over which the storm is raging. Well, the Pacific is a third of the planet. It's pretty hard to beat that fetch. Although in the roaring 40s, you get infinite fetch because there's nothing in the way of the winds in the southern roaring 40s in the southern hemisphere. So it was a huge sea going. And we secured all our gear because there was no way we could possibly work in these seas. And we put our nose into the swells, and it was just this one giant roller coaster ride. And it was amazing. We made no progress, and the key was just don't sink. And we held our nose into the sea and went backwards and backwards and backwards, because you don't want to try to make way in a sea of that size. And we were going over these 40-foot rollers. And it was sort of, as a 17-year-old, sort of like a, we had down in San Diego a roller coaster, and so it was sort of like a big roller coaster. And we're going up and down, and then out of the gloom appeared a rogue wave. Now, a rogue wave is a statistical wave. You love to get killed by a statistic. But anyway, it's a wave that occurs at the spot. It's not something that's been traveling great distances. It's actually the merging of different weather patterns, which normally and typically cancel one another out. But periodically, rarely, they all add up, and you get this giant wave. And I was up on the bridge of the ship, so I was a good 50 feet up. And we were going like that and going like that, and then the rogue wave just started coming, and it was like, there's no way we're going to go over the top of that wave. And it just ate us. We just totally consumed us. And we took on what's called green water. Green water is where you're under the ocean. And you just hope you have it's not blue splashy stuff. No, you're under the ocean, and the water's now green. You're down there. And you just rely upon your residual buoyancy to pop up the other side, and we did, which was amazing. I thought it was thrilling. I was too young to be afraid, and I was a surfer, and I thought, now that's a wave, and I became just addicted, quite honestly, to going to sea, and I've been to sea every year since. 55 years, 152 now, I think, my latest. I don't, you know, stop keeping count. But I didn't know what I wanted to be. I knew I loved the ocean, and I didn't know what I wanted to be. And so it was sort of, there were two, I thought, like most kids, because I get literally tens of thousands of letters from children that we answer every one of them, because I wrote a letter. So I went to a marine biologist who was on the cruise after the wave went by, and he was still there. And so he was a marine biologist freshly minted from Scripps in marine biology from Carl Hubbs, who was a great marine biologist. And he was not happy because he couldn't find a job. So he sort of took it out on this 17-year-old kid. And he said, the last thing you want to do is major in marine biology. You know, and he gave me this. And he just took a pin and stuck it in my balloon. And I was somewhat lost at that point. And so we came in after the storm, and we came into Santa Barbara. You see Santa Barbara, and a group of geologists came out, led by a guy by the name of Bob Norris, whose brother had been a marine biologist at Scripps, and he'd got his PhD under Francis Shepard. If you're a marine geologist, you have to trace your lineage back to Francis Shepard. But anyway, I'm third generation Shepard. But anyway, he told me about marine geology and told me about the wonderful program they were having at UC Santa Barbara. And I thought, well, that's possible. And so they came and went, and I went home and I got out the curriculum of Santa Barbara, and I looked at what I was really lost, because I wasn't sure I wanted to commit to anything at that point. And I found this degree that sounded pretty lame called the physical science degree. Now, that sounds pretty lame until you read the fine print. The fine print was that instead of a 4-year degree at 120 credits, it was a 5-year degree at 140 credits. You had to major in two physical sciences and minor in two. So I majored in chemistry and geology and minored in physics and mathematics. And so I took all the core courses in all the disciplines. I survived. I mean, to me, surviving that educational onslaught was amazing, because I was also playing college basketball and a few other things. So, but it gave me this broad-based education. An amazing, the University of California also required, I took history, I took anthropology, I took everything I could take. It was like a supermarket, I tell children. You know, you go to universities and just eat everything possible, because you'd be surprised what tastes good, even though it doesn't sound good, you know, like escargot or something like that. You know, it doesn't sound good, snails, but have you ever had it with garlic, you know? Anyway, so I took everything, and it gave me this amazing broad-based background. But then it was also a period of time in our country of great turmoil. We were in the, this was in 1960. And when I walked onto the campus at UC Santa Barbara, because it was a land-grant state university, it was mandatory ROTC. And so for men, if you were healthy and could walk, you were in ROTC. And you were, it was mandatory for your freshman and sophomore year. And so, and the true amazing thing about Santa Barbara, if you know anything about that gorgeous campus on the ocean looking out at the Channel Islands, it only had Army ROTC. Go figure. Army ROTC, might not Navy ROTC, but anyway, they only had the Army. And so I went in the Army, I had no choice. But by junior year, I had a choice of either continuing to become a commissioned officer in the Army or not. And so I said, let's see, I'm going to go to Vietnam as a lieutenant or as a private. I thought, foolishly, being a lieutenant was better until I learned this 90-second survival rate or something in combat. But I chose to become an Army officer, went off to Fort Lewis and got my training in Army infantry, and then was selected for Army intelligence. And that's not an oxymoron. So I received my commission, but I went on delay to call to active duty to go to graduate school. I was at USC in the Marine Geology program at USC. And one night there was a knock on my door, and I opened the door, and there was a naval officer standing there. And I thought he was lost. I said, you know, and he handed me an envelope. You should never open envelopes from officers, but anyway. It said, congratulations, and you should never read past the word congratulations. Your commission in Army Infantry, Army Intelligence has now been transferred. You are now a Naval Intelligence Officer, and you have 6 days to go to the Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution on Cape Cod. And I had no idea where Woods Hole was. I had to get to my Rand McNally out and find out where the heck Woods, because Scripps never told me there was another oceanographic institution. So I dropped my car, and that's how I ended up in New England. And the rest is, I spent 30 years at the Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution. A lot of the story I'm about to tell you was done there. And then I married my wife, Barbara, and we live where Barbara likes to live, which is in Connecticut. But anyway, my early passion really was fed on the ocean by an early illustration published by the National Geographic Society, done by Bruce Heason and Maria Tharp at Columbia University's Lamont Doherty. And it gave me the first view of the ocean floor. And that, even though this is a cartoon, you should not use it for navigational purposes, I was mesmerized by the complexity of the ocean floor, because we always think, you know, it's a big bucket of mud. And my eyes naturally had to go to this great feature, the mid-ocean ridge. The mid-ocean ridge runs around our Earth like the seam on a baseball for a distance of 40,000 miles, 40,000 miles, 72,000 kilometers. And if you were to put this projection on an equal area projection, this is distorted in the high latitudes by being a Mercator projection, you'd find that the mid-ocean ridge covers almost a quarter of our planet. Now think about that, almost a quarter of our planet, 23.5% of our planet is the mid-ocean ridge. And yet we didn't go to the largest feature on Earth until after the astronauts went to the moon. I mean, you let that sink in. We went to the moon, we played golf up there before we went to the single largest feature of our own planet. And even though this looks like a map, it's not. We have better maps of Mars than our own planet. And in fact, the budget, which I may be hammering on a few times, for NASA is 1,000 times larger than NOAA's Ocean Exploration Program budget. 1,000 times larger. Maybe in the Q&A we can talk about why I think, but summed up, God's up there and the devil's down there. And I think that cultural fear has a huge, plus it's dark, scares a lot of people. There was a great cartoon in the New Yorker magazine years ago where two women were having tea and one turned to the other and said, Mildred, I don't care about the bottom of the ocean, you know. And it's sort of an issue of people just don't really care about the bottom of the ocean. And so I've come to understand that and accept that, and I'll tell you how I'm getting around the fact that most people don't care. We'll get to that in a few minutes. But I was lucky, I'm a very lucky person, and certainly one of the luckiest was to be an earth scientist during the revolution of plate tectonics. When the geology books were thrown into the trash, we finally got rid of Marshall Kay's geosynclinal cycle and got into plate tectonics. You know, I've always told my students that if it's not making sense to you, the instructor probably doesn't fully understand. That when we finally do understand things, equations collapse to very simple E equals mc squared, F equals ma, that prior to that, the computations can be extremely complex. The explanation can be completely complex. And don't feel stupid if you don't understand it. They probably haven't quite figured it out yet. Science is a work in progress. And when plate tectonics came along, the silly concepts of vertical tectonics and Marshall Kay's geosynclinal cycle on mountain building went something like this before plate tectonics. You have mountains. They're being weathered and eroded. The sediments are going into the sea, flowing out from the shores, creating an inner shelf called the geosyncline and the deeper rise, the eugeosyncline. And at some moment in that period of accumulation of sediments, a mountain emerges. And I said, I got everything till that. But how is it that suddenly a mountain comes up? Well, it gets hot and all that, and comes up. This was the vertical tectonic theory we were taught in college at the time. And it just didn't set well until this elegant concept came along. No, it's not vertical tectonics, it's horizontal tectonics. And that the Earth is a creature. And see, I love that. I love, particularly when I'm talking to children, I tell them, because I basically ended up a biologist. I'm studying the largest creature on the planet itself, and that the planets can reproduce. And we'll talk a little bit about that, because that pulled me into all these other disciplines that I'd studied as an undergraduate, into chemistry and into biology and into everything. And that is that the Earth is made up of a series of pieces. We call them plates because they're relatively thin. The lithosphere, the rigid lithosphere is about 80 kilometers thick. Yet its horizontal dimensions, its X and Y dimensions can be thousands of kilometers, and that these plates are in motion. In fact, a ballet. They're a synchronized series of motions that are balanced and counterbalanced by one another's behavior. And that these plates can do one of three things, which is lovely. Not 20 things. They can either move away from one another, and that's along that entire mountain, right? Move towards one another in the great trenches and head-on collisions, or move alongside one another, like the San Andreas Fault. So they can either do this, that, or that. And what's beautiful about that is when the plates separate along that whole giant mountain range, all along, oops, let me see, I'm trying to back up. There. All along that mountain range is where the plates are moving apart. And when they do that, they rip open the Earth's outer skin. Well, when you're cut with a knife, your body produces blood, warm blood rises up from the interior of your body to the cut, hardens, coagulates, and forms new tissue. And that's how you repair yourself. The Earth's doing the same thing. If you cut into the Earth, it bleeds its molten blood, a little hotter than ours, 1200 to 1400 degrees centigrade. And that blood from beneath the lithosphere and the asthenosphere rises up in a constant effort to heal that wound, in a constant never-ending effort to heal that wound. And that material then coagulates, forms new tissue. Now, since the Earth isn't expanding or contracting, it's in steady state. If you're creating new tissue somewhere on the surface of the Earth, it must be recycling its old skin, its old tissue. And that is where the plates are in collision. And the old plate, typically the oceanic one, because it's heavier and floating deeper into the asthenosphere, so it's predisposed to sink. When continents and oceans go on in a head-on collision, the ocean always loses. The ocean will always send its It will sometimes abduct a little of itself, called ophiolites, where their cold splinters will go up and you'll find them. But most of the lithospheric plate of the ocean goes back inside the Earth, descends to make up for that creative process. But no one had actually ever witnessed the boundary of creation, gone to that great spreading area. And I love this one. This is one of my favorite slides to stare at for a while. So this is the age of the oceanic lithosphere in millions of years. Now we know the Earth is about 4.8 billion years old. So a quick glance at this would say, well, my goodness, we're barely over a quarter of a billion. So the oceans must be pretty young. On an Earth that's 4.8 billion years, the oldest is being subducted in the Hellenic trenches over here as we eat that what used to be a massive ocean called the Tethys. We're now almost consuming it, and then this finally collides, as India collided with Eurasia. Continents, once they collide, can't eat one another, so they finally stop and readjust the plates. So we're almost closing this whole Mediterranean. It's doomed to close. But right now, the oldest crust is still subducting. All the Tethys was subducted here, and ophiolites are up in the Himalayas. But you'll notice that it's fairly young. Well, that's because it's been constantly recycling itself. And that's why the Earth is pretty compared to its sister planets, the stony inner planets of Mars, Venus, and Mercury. It has a continuous facelift. So it's constantly renewing itself. It's still alive, unlike Mars, which had a plate tectonic period, but is no longer active. Earth will run that course some many billions of years from now. So I'm not really worried about the Earth. I'm more worried about us. But anyway, you'll also notice that the width of the colors are different, and that's because the plates are moving at different speeds. Plates that don't have continents on their back can move pretty fast. And so you'll see a much wider band here, so that's 20 million years as opposed to 20 million years on the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. To give you a sense of speed, the Mid-Atlantic Ridge is about 2.5, about an inch a year. Whereas down here in the faster areas of the East Pacific Rise, it's 10 to 12 centimeters per year. So fairly appreciable. So it's a constant process of crustal genesis and crustal destruction. But no one had ever gone to ground zero, gone down and actually looked at the creative process, till we held a conference actually at Princeton in 1970. Sponsored by the National Academy, and said, well, what should we do? And the obvious answer, we should go. And so we formed an alliance with the French called Project FAMOS and took our two different vehicles, Woods Hole's Alvin vehicle, which I was using a tremendous amount at the time on my PhD thesis. I was trying to reconcile the early opening of the before there was an Atlantic Ocean, there was a proto-Atlantic that was completely destroyed by the collision of the closing of the present Atlantic. And so then it opened back up in the what's called the Mesozoic period about 190 million years ago. And so my PhD thesis was dealing with the early opening of the Atlantic Ocean in the Northern Hemisphere. And I was using the Alvin in the Gulf of Maine to get to bedrock because it was so glaciated, there were so many funny rocks up there from glacial erratics that I had to get to the outcrop and actually drill into it. So I was using the submarine. So I had spent a lot of time and I had mastered using this as a graduate student. And the interesting thing about diving in deep submersibles, and I've spent 25 years, first 25 years diving in them, they're not very big. This I shot with a fisheye lens, and it looks really big. I'm 6'2", and the sphere is 6 feet. So I can't even stand up. In fact, I used to have a lot of hair, and I tore it all off on that hatch. But anyway, you do not want to be claustrophobic. You have to sort of process it. It's always wonderful until something goes wrong, and then you realize, what am I doing here? But anyway, this was our first journey into the mid-ocean ridge. This was my first article in National Geographic magazine when I dared to popularize what I was doing. Boy, did I catch a lot of trouble for that, but it's changed. But I was hammered when I wrote my first article in National Geographic, and one of my colleagues came up and he says, oh, I know what you're doing now. I read your article in National Geographic. And I had my response totally rehearsed. Well, I know the journals you read. You missed it in Nature and Science. So anyway, that's the way I had to fight it back, because I certainly caught heck for doing that. But anyway, what was interesting about our journey into the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, it was the first time we actually went into the Great Rift. And the thing is that you can enter this rift in the Arctic Ocean, go all the way around the planet, through the down the center of the Atlantic, across the Indian Ocean, all the way across the Pacific, and come aground in Baja, California, and never leave this boundary of creation. There are tens of thousands of active volcanoes running along that entire ridge. There we go. And you need to be a little careful. Fortunately, they're not violent explosions because they're A, under pressure, and B, they're coming from deep within the Earth, so they don't have a lot of volatiles. You can get pretty close to an active volcano under the ocean on the mid-ocean ridge, just like a hot spot, because the magma is coming from so deep it has no water in it. And so it doesn't have a lot of volatiles. But anyway, it's what I also find interesting, we were talking about in the energy discussion yesterday. Think about this, that you have 42,000 miles of magma chambers at 1,200 to 1,400 degrees centigrade, less than a kilometer down. And only Iceland has really begun tapping that energy because it's up where they can tap it. But think about the energy potential of tens of thousands of volcanoes that are pretty passive, that have temperatures of 12 to 1,400 degrees centigrade a kilometer down. Someday, who knows? But what was really interesting about the early explorations was we didn't see a lot of life in the deep sea, and that's because, I don't know if I can make it go black. Sometimes I can actually, there. That's what it really looks down like down there. And that's very important to know. This is what it really looks like, and we naturally have to turn on the lights. But because of this, most of the Earth is below the euphotic zone. Most of the Earth has never felt the warmth of the sun and never will. So most of the Earth is in eternal darkness. And because of that, you cannot have a photosynthesis as we know it taking place. So there's not a lot of plants, there's none, and there's nothing for them to eat, so the food chain is really dependent upon what comes from the euphotic zone in the form of marine snow, which falls at, in the deep sea, a typical is a centimeter per 1,000 years. So, you know, that much in 1,000 years. So it's not a lot of energy, and it's eaten multiple times on the way down. In fact, we call it the fecal express, because it's cycled and cycled and cycled. So by the time it arrives, there's not a whole lot to make a living out of, but there's enough to support life, and there's oxygen, as we've discovered. Forbes predicted in the 1800s there would be no life in the ocean because of the drop of oxygen with a function of depth, but there's, due to the Antarctic bottom waters, at the very near bottom, you have plenty of oxygen to support life, you just don't have the sun. We also noticed, in addition to the active volcanism, the not much life, we saw these amazing amount of cracks. They're called gyas, G-J-I-R, they're an Icelandic feature that geologists saw many, many years ago. And this is because no sooner do you create this new lithosphere that you begin to rip it apart, because it's a constant motion. The plates do not stop and start. They have too much energy in them. Once they get going, and there's not a lot of V, but there's a heck of a lot of M. And so they don't stop and start, so you have constant separation and then periodic failure of the brittle lid to an episode of volcanism that heals it for the moment, and then it tears it, heals it, tears it. So you have constant plate motion, but episodic volcanism, depending upon the speed of the plates is how episodic that is, but it's in the thousands of years. So we try not to get, we got into one of these, unfortunately, that was so big that Alvin got stuck in it, which was a bad day at the office, but we did get out. I just remember that day. But what was interesting was not only were we finding and studying this amazing plate tectonics and volcanism, was when we came across this in a later expedition on a faster spreading ridge, we came across these giant chimneys. This is what a real one looks like, a sense of scale, that's a meter. That's about my height. And these are these giant pipe organs, which actually solved a mystery that we had been pondering on as chemists, was why is the ocean salty? Why does the ocean have its chemical composition, which you would have thought we'd have cracked that one a long time ago, but chemists naturally turned to the seas as the obvious culprit due to the hydraulic cycle of water evaporating as H2O, landing on land, picking up minerals, and bringing the minerals into the sea, that must be the culprit. But the chemistry of the world's oceans is not the chemistry of the rivers in which are flowing into it. So we had a mass balance calculation problems, and it wasn't until we found these giant smokers, and it was a terrible term to use because they're not smokers at all. What it is that water with the chemicals from rivers are going into those cracks, those gyas, and a very short distance down, they're close to the magma chamber, and they go in a highly oxidated state, and they, like sulfates, and they become reduced to sulfides, and that fluid that comes back up, driven by the heat of expansion, that fluid then rises back up completely altered by its chemical interaction with the host rocks near the magma chamber. And in fact, I remember when we saw the first one, it was sort of because we were totally taken by surprise when we saw one of these guys. And I said to the Alvin pilot, let's go over and find out how hot it is. And he said, really? I said, yeah, I got the thermometer. Why do you think I brought the thermometer? I got it in front of it. I want to find out how hot it is. So we went over there, but the problem is it's coming out like a fire hydrant, so it has a tremendous updraft, so it has a Venturi effect, and it's pulling the water in, which is you're in it, and you're a neutrally buoyant, and so you're being sucked in as you get closer to it. So the pilot's having to reverse. It's sort of precarious because you don't want to get too close, but you were talking about trying to get within a meter or so, and he's not happy, and I said, you know, it's okay. So we finally got stabilized with our aft thrusters, and I could pick it up, and I stuck it into the opening, and I was looking at it, and it went poof! And our pilot made this great scientific observation, that's hot. and we pulled out the device, and we're looking at it, and it completely melted. And then my pilot said, you know, Bob, the window's made out of the same stuff. And I said, you got reversed, don't you? So we did reverse. But it was 650 degrees Fahrenheit, hot enough to melt lead, let alone our porthole, and burning our submarine. So we had to put, in the future, closing the barn door, we had to put temperature sensors all around Alvin so we would know if we were burning any part of the submarine. But what was really interesting is we were staring at it. We saw that the initial fluid was crystal clear. It was a crystal clear fluid, if you got that close. And you could see it for about 2 centimeters, 3 centimeters, it was crystal clear. And then what happened was it was being quenched, because the bottom temperature around there is about 4 degrees centigrade. It's 4 degrees because that's the maximum density of water, and it always falls down there. So you can pretty well count on ambient temperature at great depths being 4 degrees. So you got 4 degrees and 350 degrees centigrade coming in contact, and you're quenching the fluid. And that what you're really looking at is microcrystals. It's not smoke at all. You're looking at microcrystals of what are called polymetallic sulfides. Copper, lead, silver, zinc, and gold, and minerals like pyrite, chalcopyrite, sphalerite, and anhydrite that are being formed before your eyes. I mean, as a geologist, it's always interesting to pick up a rock in New England that's, you know, Ordovician, you know, 350 million years old, and another one to watch one made in front of you, and pick up a rock that's a day old. And so we were watching this process. And what's interesting about this entire deposit is commercial grade ore of copper, lead, silver, zinc, and gold. And I always remind my NASA friends, how much of that have you found on the moon? Think about it. Just extrapolate in your mind for a second. This is occurring along 42,000 miles of the mid-ocean ridge, but it's even better than that. All the mid-ocean ridge, all the ocean crust started at that point. So the entire oceanic lithosphere that is easily 60% of the planet could have that. And in fact, we find it in the very old Precambrian shield regions of Canada. They're mining up there are old black smokers. The classic mines of Cyprus that drove the Bronze Age, 80% of the copper of the Bronze Age came from black smokers when the closing of the Tethys pushed Cyprus out of the ocean and to be found by the ancients to mine copper from. The copper mines of Oman are all ancient black smokers. So the mineral potential is quite amazing in addition to the heat potential. But this blew us all away when we came across this Disneyland of creatures completely by surprise. We didn't have a single biologist on the expedition because they all chose to pass on the expedition. They said, we don't want to look at rocks. We invited a bunch on our historic expedition. I was co-chief scientist with Dick von Herzen, who was a heat flow guy, and we led an expedition in the Galapagos Rift in 1977 when we stumbled across these amazing oases of life characterized by these giant worms, commonly a meter and a half in length, that had a pint of human-like blood, that stuck their lungs out. That's what they're doing right now. They're sticking their feathery lungs out to ingest the toxic fluids that are coming out of the vents that are laden with hydrogen sulfide, a deadly, deadly gas in solution. And they were ingesting it. And around them were these giant clams. These are not recommended to eat. I had a graduate student eat some of one, and he's still alive. But they smell terrible. They smell like rotten eggs, hydrogen sulfide. But what's really odd about them is they too have hemoglobin in their bodies because they're living in a world that's very, has a high flux environment of very reduced to oxygenated and back. So they're in a world that wants to be oxygen depleted, but they need the oxygen to live, and so they need to store it. So they're using the blood, there's a sort of a battery to store their oxygen if they have a strong puff of H2S. But they're then ingesting it, and when we dissected the first one, that was quite amazing. We did actually bring some dissecting knives straight out of the galley. But anyway, we cut them open, and it had no internal organs. Because I, you know, living in New England, I had lots of clams and a half shell, and there was no mouth, gut, or digestive system. Their entire body had been taken over by what we now call an extremophile, a cyanobacteria called an extremophile, that had figured out over eons of time how to duplicate photosynthesis in the dark and replicate the photosynthetic process in the dark. And as you know, many of us believe that this is one of the early conditions of our planet because they can live in a non-oxygen environment if necessary. But through evolutionary time, they've begun to take on more oxygen when it became possible. But what they're doing is doing something. We know that the ocean has been around a long time. The oldest rock on the Earth is 3.8 billion years that we found, and it's a sedimentary rock in Greenland, so we know there was an ocean. So we know the ocean's been around from very early in Earth history. We know the plates have been moving for a long, long time. So this setting has been around for a long, long time. And so it's very possible this is where life began on our planet. I always tell people that aren't into all of that, if you have trouble being related to a monkey, try this, you know. But the problem I was having, I mean, where amazing stuff was going on, and this was all done in the 70s. I had been diving, doing my postdoc work and then on to get tenure, and I dove in anything they had. Some of them were not so good to dive in. This one almost killed me. This one's very luxurious. This is a nuclear research submarine with wheels and windows. And when I was in naval intelligence, we used it a lot. It can go down for a month. You eat a lot of tater tots. And this, tragically, is the submarine in which Bruce Hazen died on the Reykjanes Ridge, was in this submarine. But I've done crazy ones. This was the one I was in just a few months ago. Last year, this is nuts. I mean, this is more of a fighter pilot. You can do barrel rolls. But the problem with these submarines is that you spend most of your time going to work. The average depth of the ocean is 4,000 meters. When I dove in this vehicle into the Cayman Trough to the deepest volcanoes in the world, it was 6 hours to work in the morning and 6 hours home. It was taking me 12 hours to commute to work in a 24-hour day, so my average bottom time was like an hour. And Alvin, Titanic's average depth of the ocean, 14,000 feet, 4,000 meters, 13,000. I was spending 2.5 hours to get to work in the morning, 2.5 hours home at night. So I was spending most of my time commuting and getting very little lateral exploration. The average distance traveled in a deep submersible is a mile. Well, you're on a 40,000-mile mountain range, so you have great job security. There's no doubt about it. But I'm a little impatient, as some of my friends will say. And I wanted to come up with a better way of going to work. And this, so I punched out of the submarine. I said, I need to go and clear my head. So I went to Stanford in 79 and 80. I taught geology and geophysics at Stanford, but I was really there to just think about, did I really want to continue doing this for the next zillion years? And this was an exciting time to be in that neck of the woods, with Silicon Valley just becoming known as Silicon Valley, with the development of fiber optics and microprocessors and digital imagery. And I should have said, hey, let's make a cell phone, but I didn't. damn, I should have done that. But I was a little too focused. I said, how can I use this amazing technology to make my job better? And I sketched this cartoon, which I later had published in National Geographic in the December issue. It's got the panda bears on it. 1981, I said, this is really the future in undersea exploration. And it's all about, I coined the word telepresence with Sitko's now copyrighted and permitted me to use my word. But anyway, the idea was, I don't know if any of you have seen the movie Avatar. But those of you that have seen Avatar, what it's about is where we're headed, and that is spending most of your time out of your body. And in the movie Avatar, for those that haven't seen it, it was about these creatures that were not called Navis, and they were about 8-9 feet tall. They were blue-green, had funny little ears, they had a tail, and they did crazy stuff. And they were at war with the bad guys, and some of humans were trying to help them. So they decided that they would help them by becoming Navis. So there's a scene in the movie. Remember the scene? They go in and there's a Navi laying on a slab in an operating room, and this guy, Jake, a war veteran, lays down next to the Navi and blinks his eyes and ends up in the Navi. Remember that scene? Now, 90% of the people don't remember what happened immediately after that. You remember what happened when he woke up in the Navi? He did something. It freaked them all out. He got up and ran out of the room, and they thought he completely freaked out. Now, do you remember why he got up and ran? Because he was a war veteran, and he couldn't, his body, his legs didn't work anymore. So he was in a wheelchair. But when he woke up in the Navi and saw he had feet again, he got up and ran. And they caught up with him, and they say, are you okay? And he says, yeah. Well, why'd you do this? He said, I wanted the wind in my face again. I wanted the wind in my face again. He didn't care. This is the important point, that he was 8 feet tall, blue-green, had funny ears and a tail. He didn't care. Because he now had, his body had failed him. His human body had failed, but his spirit was there. Well, most of our planet and all of the universe is not friendly to our body. We've evolved ourselves into a corner. We live on 18% of the Earth, and none of the universe, and none of the solar system. So our body, in some ways, has evolutionarily led us into a corner. But we can now build Navis that can carry our spirit. And it's all about spirit movement. Now, Barbara and I have two children who we commonly see these things in their ears. And we have to go up and hi and unplug them. Okay. They're not generally there when they physically are there, because I can remember my son was off at a boarding school, and he came home from the boarding school, and he had all these laptops. And I went into his room on a holiday, and I said, what are you doing? Hanging out. And sure enough, every laptop had a person on it that was just hanging out. They may be talking, they died on. Hey, hi, Larry, how are you? And I could wait, and they'd go, hey, how are you? And so I asked my son, I said, could you give me the latitude and longitude of where you are right now? And he says, Dad, I'm in a cloud. It has no latitude. So they may look like us, they're not us. Okay, so I've actually joined the ranks, just like the guy in the movie moved over to help the Navis. I have gone back, and I am now living in their world, and it's an amazing world. So let me take you, we'll get to it near the end, because I want to talk about what we're doing with children. But so I come up with this cartoon, and I go back to Woods Hole, and I try to, the National Academy had supported me for years and years and years. I always, you know, had very high success rate with NSF, and I said, let's build this, and they said, no, we're, it's a little too crazy and all that. So I went to, so I said, okay, I could always rely upon the Navy. Because I've had a, I have the second oldest grant in the history of the Office of Naval Research behind Walter Monk. And I met his grandson today, yesterday, and I said, how's Walter doing? And I hope you didn't see the reason for asking the question. I hope he lives forever, but I just want to be one day longer so I can have the oldest grant in the history of the Office of Naval. But I went to my Navy and I said, what do you think? And they said, interesting. And so then I had to make it, they you know, you have two fears in academia. One is they didn't fund you, and the second one is, oh my God, they did. And so I went to the Navy, and then they funded, and I, oh my God, you know. So then they said, build it. So I ran up to MIT, because we had a great program, a joint program in ocean engineering. I was in the Applied Ocean Physics and Engineering Department at Woods Hole, and I had lots of really bright kids that are in our joint program with MIT. And so I went to start convincing them not to go on to General Motors and make a lot of money in robotics, but to come down and set up my laboratory. So we created the Deep Submergence Laboratory in 1982. And we began systematically building the building blocks. It took us 30 years of systematic building to get to where we are, where I am right now, which is going to be, I'll be there as soon as I can get there. But anyway, but the whole idea was to have a telepresence and move spirits around, because if we could move our spirits around, they can move at the speed of light, they're indestructible. Okay, and so we could beam you down, Scotty, and as soon as you want to go to the bathroom, you could beam up and go to the bathroom, although it was a little odd to be on the bottom of the ocean and then go to the bathroom up in a ship, but you got used to the mind warps. When you do electronic travel, you have to get used to being, and it's a little, you get used to it. You know, it's like airplanes, you get used to it. But anyway, so we began developing all, but the idea was to ultimately not even be on the ship and turn the entire ship into a drone. Because we are land-breathing, air-breathing, land-loving animals, and I actually do love land. I love going out, but I'm more interested in discovery than how I do it. So I don't mind if I just send my spirit out there. So the Navy said, we'll fund it, but we have some jobs for you to do. As a naval intelligence officer, we've lost two submarines during the Cold War, the Thresher and the Scorpion. And in the case of the Scorpion, they're carrying nuclear weapons. And in both cases, they have had active reactors. And we're thinking of, we've signed the SALT Treaty, and we're thinking of putting nuclear containment vessels in the ocean. We want to know if that's a good idea or not. So let's look at a worst case scenario. It's far worse than a nuclear containment vessel. This is an active, these are reactors down there. And the in this case, nuclear weapons. But we don't want the Soviets to know where they are. So we need a cover story. And I went, have I got the cover story for you? I said, I got this great cover story, because the Thresher is to the west of the Titanic lost sight, Scorpion's to the east. So I said, why don't we tell the world I'm looking for the Titanic? And they said, yeah, that's a good idea, yeah. They were furious when I found it, I got to tell you. they were really pissed. And I promised them I'd never do it again, but I did it multiple times. But the idea was to use the beauty of our technology. We knew, you know, everyone had been trying. Columbia had been trying. Scripps had been trying. The French, a lot of people. And I learned a lot. I don't have, maybe in the Q&A I can talk to you about how I used my work on the Thresher and Scorpion. It actually taught me how to find the Titanic. It was a very interesting insight, but I couldn't tell anyone about it until they declassified it. So I can tell you now and you don't get shot or anything. But the idea was going out with a vehicle system that never came up. And that's the power of telepresence. The vehicle never comes up. You go out, you launch it, stay down for days and days, weeks and weeks, and you really get bottom time. And then this was my first command control center at the moment, actually a moment of discovery. It's a little primitive compared to what I'll show you in a few minutes. It looks like two cans and a string to what I had, but it was good enough. We had a live feed, it was black and white, it was on a coax, wasn't on a fiber yet. And we got slow scanning, black and white, was good enough to track down. Well, we did our job. We went and then on to the Thresher and the Scorpion, and we found the reactors, and we looked at we measured the radioactivity. We caught animals that were living in the wreckage and looked at their, with Sunnybrook, looked at the radioisotope uptake in their fatty tissues, and they had none, and they'd gone through countless generations. So both reactors had scrammed. and both reactors had actually buried themselves in deep sea mud, so there's nothing going on there. But anyway, we then went on after that and found the Titanic. And then we had to wait a year till 1986 to come back out because they wanted us to go inside the forward torpedo room with our vehicle system. So we get another cover story, and that was to go back to the Titanic with our submarine. We brought with us our first little remotely operated vehicle called Jason June. We were never develop in series, always develop in parallel and make assumptions about convergence of technologies. So we didn't have a fiber yet. We said, well, it's going to come. So we blew the signal through a short distance back to the submarine so we could jam it in a very short amount of cable. Didn't need the fiber to the surface, and literally used the submarine to carry everything. And we went up onto the bow, and then with the little vehicle, we could actually go down the grand staircase because we couldn't penetrate with the physical size of the submarine. So we parked near the grand staircase and then went down inside and went six decks in, and the chandeliers are hanging. It was pretty amazing. But then after that, we went back to the Scorpion and went inside the Scorpion. But then after that, Geographic sort of liked the fact that that's number one still in the history of cable television for ratings. They said, would you do that again? And sure. And so we went off and we did the Bismarck, and this chilling swastika is still painted there. We went on to the Battle of Midway. We've done lots of Guadalcanal. We've done a lot of things for National Geographic because it helps pay the bill, as you'll learn in a minute. But people always ask me, how do you know you found the right ship? This one said Yorktown on the back of it. So. But naturally, you get hooked. You know, when you're in science, as you know, you begin on a journey and you don't know where it's going to take you. And it's never a straight line. It takes you where it takes you. And so naturally, you're always asking questions, and a discovery spawns more questions. And the one is, okay, these are steel ships. They're made out of steel. No big deal that they're still there. But what about the Ancient Mariner? And so actually, I came to Harvard here to a group of archaeologists, Larry Stager, the head of the Semitic Museum, and others. Robinson was one of the archaeologists at Harvard. This would have been 1987. And we began an exercise on how many ancient shipwrecks, how many ancient ships have had a bad day. And we began running numbers, and we kept coming up with a million. And we thought, no, and we kept going over the numbers. But when you start around easily 4,000 BC, it doesn't take you long to get a million. And so we realized, my God, a million have had a bad day. And so we then naturally, where are these million guys? And that naturally took us to the Mediterranean. And the school of thought at that time, this was embodied in George Bass, who was the godfather of marine archaeology at Texas A&M. He used to be at the University of Pennsylvania. We went to Texas A&M, created the Institute of Nautical Archaeology. And George is a good friend, and I said, George, where do you find ancient shipwrecks? And he said, well, we find them right along the shoreline. And I said, well, George, where are you looking? He says, well, right along the shoreline. And I said, Bob, we're scuba divers. You know, we don't work below 100 feet. Well, 100 feet is about the width of that green dot. Okay, and I said, well, what about, they didn't go out there. And I said, I'm not an archaeologist, but I am a mariner. And I know that the closer to shore, the more dangerous it is, because you run into things, rocks. Piracy was launched from land where they saw you and they just outsailed you. So the pirates weren't roaming around like the pirates of the Caribbean. They just sat and waited to see a gun that went out after them. You know that storms are much more violent in shallow water where the energy shoals. And they're businessmen and they want to get from A to B as fast as possible. So I said, I'll bet you they are deep water trade routes. And I said, let's pick an easy one. Here's Carthage in modern Tunisia, and here's Rome. And Carthaginians, didn't get along with the Romans, and through the Punic Wars were finally vanquished by the Romans and then became a vassal state to Rome, particularly during the Roman Republic when they were the breadbasket for Rome during the Roman riots. And so I'm thinking, let's go back to that period of time and let's look at that ancient mariner who seasonally made his journey to Rome. Do you really think he went da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da- And I drew a straight line between Carthage and Rome, and I said, he went that way. Okay. So the question was, how was I going to do it? So for first place, I had to get in the head of the Carthaginian sailor. So here's a Carthaginian sailor, circa, this would be 350 BC, AD, something like that. And they're carrying lots of things to Rome. Naturally, they had to bring lions to eat the Christians in the Colosseum. But they brought a tremendous amount of wheat and wine stored in a jar called an amphora, which is basically a rock. It's baked clay, and it turns in, fundamentally, it's a rock. So it has long shelf life. And I said, so this guy's going to go with five other sailors to Rome with 3,000 bottles of wine. What are they going to do along the way? Do you think they'll dip into the sauce? Absolutely. Are they supposed to? No. What are they going to do with the evidence? Chuck it. So I said, okay, here's my theory. Very complicated. They drank and they threw the empties over. Okay, so they're going to go that way and they're going to start drinking and they're going to throw the things over. So I said, the sedimentation rate here is in a matter of centimeters per millennium. So the evidence is still there. This is CIS, is that the program on TV? Whatever it is. CIS, I said. So the evidence should still be there even though it's thousands of years old. So I'm going to look for a highway, an I-95 without an adopt-a-highway program. Running from here. So I started in Gagliari, Sardinia, and went perpendicular to Trapani in western Sicily, knowing I would have to cross the line. And I went looking for empties. And I went, and I went, and I was a little nervous. First 100 miles, I didn't see a single empty till I hit a narrow band, 4 kilometers wide. That's how good their navigation was. And I hit thousands of empties. And they drank all the way to Rome. Stop drinking right about here, I think. And so once I found that highway, I just drove the highway, and I started finding ship after ship after ship after ship. And this one was one of the earlier ones, the Skirky Delta. This is his bilge pump, pipe. But this is as discovered 1st century BC. 1st century BC, just sitting there. And so I started doing it all over the Mediterranean. This was off of the Sinai. This is 750 BC, the Iron Age, the time of Homer, just sitting there. A cargo of wine from a Phoenician shipwreck, because we could tell by the, as you can see, the idols, they had some, back in the living quarters, we found articles that Larry Steger at Harvard clearly identified as Phoenician. And this was near Ashkelon, where he'd done all his work. But this is the ship. This is their high-tech anchor, a rock with a hole in it. And then over the next several years, we just found them. We cracked the Rosetta Stone on where to find them. We've found more ancient shipwrecks than anyone on the planet in the deep sea. And we found that the last place you want to do is go in shallow water because the trawlers are destroying ancient antiquity. In fact, we have a beautiful exhibit at the Lyman Allen Museum, if you're down in New London, Connecticut, a beautiful exhibit on the destruction of all this ancient antiquity by deep sea trawlers. Trawl down to 500 meters. And so if you go below 500 meters, it's nirvana. There are shipwrecks after shipwrecks. But you'll notice that the ship's gone, and that's because there's oxygen and there's a wood borer. Actually, Harvard is the center of expertise. Ruth Turner at the Museum of Comparative Zoology did her early work, sponsored by the Navy, actually, on the wood-boring mollusk, the teredo, the shipworm. Well, the teredo is pervasive. Where there's a food supply, you'll find teredos eating ships. But several years in, this was 1975, I read a book by one of my idols, a half engineer, half oceanographer at Scripps, Willard Bascom, who said if you really want to find the ships perfectly preserved, you want to go in the Black Sea. And so we couldn't get in there during the Cold War, and now it's getting hot again, but during the Cold War, we couldn't get in. So I don't know what you were thinking when the Berlin Wall came down. I said, I'm going to the Black Sea. That's what I was thinking. And because we knew that this is the story of Jason and the Argonauts in search of the Golden Fleece, so we know that since pre-classical time, pre-Bronze Age, that ancient mariners were going in here. The Greeks came in and colonized this whole area. In fact, an area here near Sebastopol, which no longer I can go to, was called Chersonesus. And it was sort of an area where the Greeks established a colony to trade with the Scythians. And so this was quite an area of maritime trade. We worked a lot off of a place called Sinope, where we found all the pottery, where they were creating all the kilns, where all the amphoras were being made. And so we thought, there's a trade route right here. And that would take us across the center of the Black Sea. And the interesting thing about the Black Sea, and don't have time to go into it a lot, was it was a And about 8,000 BPE, it was freshwater lake. And then there's a great book by two scholars at Columbia University, Walter Pittman and Bill Ryan, called Noah's Flood, that talk about, was this where the great biblical flood occurred, given that Mount Ararat is right over here? Was there a massive deluge of one big influx of water that unlike the Holocene transgression off the rest of the world, where it stopped and started and stopped and started, there would be only one shoreline. We went in there and actually found that shoreline that they proposed right in here. And we gathered shells from that shoreline. It was 155 meters down. And we had two kinds of mollusks. And we dated the mollusks, and they were 15-year spread from 5,000 years to 15,000 years. And then we looked at their species, and we saw a sudden change from freshwater mollusks to saltwater mollusks at 7,500 BPE, which is about 5,000 BC, which is the time of oral history. So good stuff. And in the book, they also proposed that deluge, because they lost, due to that flood, they lost all this real estate, and there were these people displaced, and that's where they got in trouble as geologists. But Spencer Wells' work in DNA research in Europe shows a sudden influx of DNA from this area around the same time. So fascinating stuff going on, really good stuff. But we were not there for that. We were there to search the anoxic water when that flood occurred, the water came in, salt water replaced the fresh water, and then it was trapped. It was not being refreshed by either saline refreshment that occurs in the Ionian Sea into the deeper waters of the Mediterranean, or the Antarctic bottom water that refreshes the deeper parts of the world's oceans through the Antarctic bottom water circulation from the poles. The water became trapped, it went stagnant, it went anoxic. This is the largest reservoir of hydrogen sulfide on the planet. And so that meant that if anything went in there, there would not be any organisms to eat the ships. And that's what was Wilder Bascom's theory. So we went in there and actually searched this trade route, and sure enough, found perfectly preserved wooden ships. Wood has a life expectancy in a well-oxygenated ocean of a couple of years before the wood borers will colonize it and get it. And they reproduce, they have 50% of their body's reproductive organs, so they take it very seriously. And all the deck of the Titanic's eaten, and all that's left of the dead Torito shells. So we found this beautifully in the anoxic. This is dead mud. There's nothing living in it. And we began excavating, and we took the dust off. You can see the carpenter's ad mark. This is actually Byzantine. This is about 1,500 years old. But you can see the carpenter's ad mark. These are lasers we use for measurement. That's 10 centimeters. But then we began to unearth the artifacts themselves in mint condition. Imagine that artifacts have been under the ocean, still has beeswax drippings, 1,500 years. And then just recently, just before we left, we found a classical shipwreck, 500 BC, with human remains. So think of the DNA that we'll get out of those shipwrecks and then be able to really know who these ancient mariners were. So the opportunity is amazing. But, so that was the first part to show you there's a lot down there than just mud. So now, what have you done for me lately? Okay. Well, what I've done is I've created a new institute at the University of Rhode Island Graduate School of Oceanography. And I'm the director of the Center for Ocean Exploration, and also created the Ocean Exploration Trust. And by being president of both, I can have a conversation. And I can actually mandate the two work together. So we have an amazing alliance between the Ocean Exploration Trust, which is a private 501c3 incorporated in the state of Connecticut, and the University of Rhode Island Graduate School of Oceanography. And what's wonderful about having two organizations is I can get around all the ridiculous rules of universities by just doing it through the trust. I travel. I mean, there's so many ways I can get around every stupidity that a university has by saying, don't do it, we'll do it, you know, and it's really nice. I can really move at a speed of light. We don't charge overhead in the trust. Why? Everyone goes to sea. There's no one in the trust that doesn't go to sea and earn their keep by going to sea. So I have zero overhead. Our grants, people love that. Okay. Every dollar sticks. So what are we doing? Well, I went out, and because my hero was Captain Nemo, I acquired my own ship in 2009 from East German spy ship. They came up on the market for next to nothing. Actually, I got it given to me free by someone. And I then poured a lot of money into it to turn it into a state-of-the-art exploratory platform. Now, the challenge you have, the challenge I had is, like I said, I spent 30 years living at the trough of the National Science Foundation with everybody. But as you know, we used to have a 90% success rate. We're now below 10% on average. So I've spent a lot of time writing for books. So I said, forget that. Can I create an economic engine that doesn't require a dime from the National Science Foundation? Can I actually do that? And so I decided I'd give it a shot in my waning moments. I thought, what the hell? So first place, I had to go and create an Office of Ocean Exploration in the government. So I served on two commissions, the President Clinton Commission, and we created the Office of Ocean Exploration with a budget. Are you ready? $4 million. Hey, you know, got the camel's nose under the tent. Then I was asked by President Bush to serve on the Ocean Commission for Ocean Policy. And we reinforced the need and then wrote needed dedicated ships of exploration. And so we then, I think, what are we up to, Jesse? 28 million or something like that? We got it up to about 28 million. And they give me 4 of the 20. Because I don't want them you don't want the government to fund, capture you. My father told me years ago, to have 12 masters is to have none. So the key is don't let anyone own more than the 20% of you. That's dangerous to have anyone own more than 20% of you. So I have a very diversified portfolio. But I'll tell you how I'm playing it. So the fundamental thing I'm doing is going back to the Challenger expedition. See, having done 55 years of this and having done 150 expeditions, and I look back in hindsight, 2020, and I look at what was the really important thing. It was the discovery of hydrothermal vents. It was the discovery of black smokers, the discovery of Lost City. None of those were in my NSF grants. I had a wonderful grant to get me close, and then I tripped over something more important. And so I knew that, in all honesty, the best grant you could write to NSF was where you knew the answer already and didn't tell anybody. You get amazing logic. We all do it. I'm looking at all the smiles around the room. Look at all those. How many have maybe heard about that, right? Okay, right. You know the answer, you don't tell anybody, and you go, logic is impeccable because it's going to lead to an already known conclusion. So then you spend it on a hunch. There was a great French philosopher who said, it's by logic that you prove, but by intuition that you discover. And we all know that to be true, but we not have the freedom to really go with a hunch. We do it, but we have to come up with a contrived way. And finally, I said, why don't we just be honest and say, call a spade. And I said, look, we don't know what's out there. We've made amazing discoveries, and we've looked at less than 0.1%, please. So why don't we create a program of pure honesty? And let's just go. So I found I had to put together a team. And the team consists of two kinds of players: graduate students and postdocs, mostly graduate students that have nothing to lose with change. Change threatens power. So fortunately, with the aging of America and the world, the other group are what I call the old farts. And to be in my advisory board, you have to fail the following question: when did you get tenure? And you have to stumble on, God, I don't like that. You're in. Okay. So I do not work in the middle of the scientific estate. I work on the edges of it, at the very early stages of it and at the very older stages. Because the older stages, people, A, have wisdom that we can finally have enough life to use it, and B, we just want to know. And we don't have a dog in the fight anymore. We don't care if our name's the first author on a paper. We're way past that. We just want to know. So I call this group together, and we're going to call them together. If you want to see how sausage is made, come to the AGU, the weekend before the AGU in San Francisco in December. We're doing a workshop. We put out a white paper call. We said, we're going to take the Nautilus, which I'm going to show you this amazing tool in a second. If you had the Nautilus and all of its capabilities, and we're in a particular area of the world, what would you do with it, knowing the data is open sourced as it's collected? And you're probably not going to be on the ship. So you don't really have a huge investment in it other than an intellectual investment. We got 88 groups of scientists proposing, if I had your ship from the Panama Canal to there, I would go here and why. And they will dance in front of my old farts. And we will then select a group and we will then do those expeditions. So it's a community-based driven process of all the data being open sourced as collected. So if you move fast, good. If you're slow, sorry. So, but let me first tell you the awesome technology behind it, because the concept behind it is we're running an emergency room of a hospital. We have no idea what the ambulance is going to deliver Sunday morning. We work 24 hours a day. 24 hours a day. So 4-on-8 off shift, round the clock, we're working 24 hours a day. Because it's always dark down there. So a discovery could be made at any moment. So we have all around the United States doctors on call. Teams of scientists who are willing to be awakened 2 o'clock in the morning and put things on their iPhone and cell phone. And so we do it by having an amazing capability. We're going to be focusing mostly, how am I doing time-wise?
10 minutes.
I'm beg your pardon?
10.
Okay. I'm going to flash forward to our program in exploring the America's EEZ, because I want to talk on that. I want to also talk to you about my outreach. But right now, our focus is on exploring our own country. And we're using amazing technology to show what's out there, because if we can prove that there's oil and gas, if we can prove there's mineral resources or new fisheries, it becomes part of our country, rare earths as well. But, and places that need to be protected. But what we want to do is to have the state-of-the-art technology. So we have amazing mapping systems on the hull of the ship that can digitize at full speed. We can completely digitize new ocean terrain, go into areas where we know nothing. We can also see textural characteristics at the bottom. So this is all done at full speed at 14 knots, at 4 knots, at 12 knots on a 7-kilometer swath with a mapping. So we're really mapping very rapidly. And we can see oil and gas coming out of the bottom of the ocean. So it's huge detection for hydrocarbons, full speed. But then we go in with our vehicle systems, amazing vehicle systems. Remotely operated vehicle systems that can operate 24 hours a day from an amazing command center, operated with shifts around the clock. Pilots, co-pilots, navigators, video engineers, closed-loop robotic controls, force feedback manipulators, everything that you could get, and the ability to then network that throughout, not only networking it throughout workstations, but putting it on a satellite. So here's the scientist in the back of the bus, but most of it is then you make discoveries, a new shipwreck, a new crazy siphonophore. We got 4 million hits on our Facebook page on this guy alone. Fish that walk, German U-boat we bumped into in the Gulf of Mexico this summer. Crazy features that we've never seen before in our life, Lost City, where you have water going down to the mantle, hitting peridotite, serpentinizing it, creating an exothermic reaction, bringing fluids up that are 11, pH of 11, equal to Drano, with extremophiles in them. But so we're using that to then network off the ship. We have a facility down at Rhode Island where we built the Inner Space Center, the Center for Ocean Exploration, all run by my students. So we have students at both ends. Students at sea, very few scientists are in the game until we need them. And then we use Internet 2 Level 3, which is the new internet around the country at 10 gigabits of bandwidth, and we're able to create command centers. It's $15,000. At any university, you can create a command center, and the scientists can then enter the game with their students. But here's the part I want to finish on in the last few minutes I have, is our education program. How I'm using this technology to try to capture the next generation. My argument about outreach is it's not about science. It's about scientists as role models. We are a star-based system. We need to have role models. We call it the core of exploration, because Lewis and Clark was the core of discovery. and I mandated it be 55% women in positions of leadership authority, and that we would have the demographics of our country in the core. A child must see their face 20 years out. If they don't see their face on that core, the answer is sent, I can't play. They don't let me in. And so we have done amazing amount of work to make sure that our core reflects the citizens of our country, and it's not lost on our children. We've trained them at our Interspace Center. We train them to be spokespersons, and we embed in every watch and educator that's reporting out to the outside world. And then we embed them in the core. And we wear uniforms, which my academicians had a little trouble with. I said, sorry, get off the ship. You are a team member. You're not, no titles. You are a member of the core. Because there's only three PhDs up there like any football team. There's only three quarterbacks. But there's all these other players, and the kid needs to know there's a lot of positions to play on this team. And they're all embedding them throughout the ship, are all these amazing, amazing kids. I love this one. Our honor students, we have rising, just like me, junior in high school, had to start there. Third year college, first year graduate school, a postdoc PhD. All the way, she just looks down the line. You don't have to say anything else. She knows I can get there. I did a recent meeting where I called the kids that follow my program, and this was in Beaumont, Texas. Beaumont, Texas. And I said, I'm going to come and talk about ocean exploration. 10,500 middle school children showed up. The president of Lamar University said, Bob, I want to tell these kids you just set an all-time attendance record previously held by Elton John. Okay? And it's all about that. It's all about taking that and turning it into an exciting, exciting thing. Our job, and we have amazing educational outreach that goes from K, I borrow from Buzz Lightyear, from K to infinity and beyond. It's not K through 12, it's not K through 16, it's from the moment you pop your eyes open until they close. And turning these young, we call them ambassadors, they're very young when they come out on our ship too. The person I've actually selected to replace me, Katie Croft-Bell, MIT graduate in engineering. I met her in 1999. She went on to England to get a master's in archaeology. Think about that, an engineering degree at MIT, master's in archaeology, and then was a student of mine for 7 years, and I hooded her 2 years ago with her PhD in geology and geophysics. She takes no prisoners. And so it's that kind of role modeling and that really makes it all possible. So I think I've... 2 minutes. Run the tape. I got a 4-minute tape. I want to show you the what we're doing now because it's so exciting. It's where we're taking all of our programs and focusing in communities. So run the videotape.
Hi, I'm Allison Fundus, Director of Education for the Ocean Exploration Trust. Since 2009, the Trust has worked to promote science, technology, engineering, and mathematics education around the world using the excitement of exploration and technological innovation to inspire and motivate the next generation of scientists and engineers. We use a tiered approach for our STEM programs. At the first tier, we inspire tens of millions of people around the world through television specials, a growing online presence, and outreach with museums, aquaria, and science centers. Diving deeper, we engage students at all levels in their classrooms and after-school programs through curriculum-based programming. At the next level, we educate hundreds of high school, undergraduate, and graduate students, providing opportunities to sail on board our exploration vessel Nautilus. Formal and informal educators also join us at sea to help communicate our mission and discoveries to the public while they gain valuable professional experience. Finally, we collaborate with top scientists in a variety of fields who form the core of the Nautilus Exploration Program. We have had many successes with these programs over the past 5 years, and we're now taking a new approach to weave them all together around a central idea, community.
We launched this in June in Fort Lauderdale. It was the first community we brought aboard. We're now six more
we have created our community-based STEM program to increase the impact our individual efforts can have in a single location. Believing that the whole is greater than the sum of its parts, we aim to have each of our programs reinforce each other within various communities. When we launch a community partnership, we start by identifying the key organizations already involved in STEM education. from local schools to after-school programs to universities, museums, aquaria, and science centers. We work with each community to weave those organizations together with the Nautilus Exploration Program as the central theme.
I'm just absolutely thrilled to be given this opportunity to be able to share what I am going to learn and to share data that I'm going to collect on board with students is just an awesome experience.
For some members of each community, that means joining the Corps of Exploration and spending time out at sea on Nautilus. We bring middle and high school students on board for our Ambassador and Honors Research programs, undergraduate and graduate students on board as interns, and formal and informal educators on board as science communication fellows.
When we do all these STEM initiatives and STEM programs that link us to Common Core, then it seems much more important to them and their desire for learning becomes more concrete.
After their time at sea, these students and educators return home as ambassadors for ocean exploration and role models for their peers, promoting STEM education from within their community. These new members of our Corps don't have to wait until they return to shore to start getting involved. To reach a broader cross-section of each community, we take advantage of a special feature of Nautilus called telepresence. With our advanced satellite system, we connect explorers at sea with learners in classrooms, after-school programs, museums, aquaria, science centers, and other public venues. Once we've built a network of STEM-connected communities, the second level of linking begins. We'll bring together representatives from all of our partner regions to collaborate and share what they've learned each year from their experience, so successes and lessons learned can be shared and improved upon. We plan to work with the same communities year after year to build up the ranks of our role models and to grow our program within each community. STEM education is at the core of the Ocean Exploration Trust mission, and we're looking to build sustainable programs across the country to engage, inspire, and educate the next generation of scientists, engineers, and explorers. There's a lot of ocean left to explore, and while we're out on the cutting edge of science, we can't wait to see what we can build with a community like yours.
So a very exciting program, and thank you for giving me all your time this morning. Thank you. I can take something else. Thank you. Thank you very much.